So the usually in Noyakishi system, we insist on the mixed cropping, not monoculture. That's some of the very basic principles. That's why we call it biodiversity. It's a diverse system of the species and the varieties. So that produces, if you look at the system yield of the system, so then it produces more with regard to a particular system. You calculate from the one household how much they're producing, total yield is much than, for example, if we'd have done only monoculture from there, a single particular kind of crop. How would it look like? Like, say, these are all uncultivated food. These are not, they didn't have to really just cultivate those foods available to them. And, you know, it'll be a surprise. This is a girl, again, collecting food from this kinds of system. But the most surprising thing is this. 40% of food in the rural area, if you maintain biodiversity, you can collect from uncultivated spaces. No, just you. Only this statistic if you think about. If you go for the modern industrial food production, this 40% food is not available to these little girls who are really picking it up daily, on the daily basis. So this is, you know, my appeal would be to you to think differently, think innovatively, and also develop our capacity to critique the present practice of agriculture and the kind of technology we really promote, the kind of agriculture policy we really go for. So, and then, you know, also, you know, 15 to 17% of the households who has no land, you know, we call the hardcore poor. Many of you are quite concerned about it. These hardcore poor can collect food only from uncultivated sources without the mediation of the market. So market is not a solution that you have to bring everybody to the market. That is necessary. I mean, that's not the whole issue. Issue is that is not the solution for the food crisis. So these are very barren land. You know, this is the chore land where we are growing food. Usually, they couldn't produce food in the chawl land, but this particular picture will show you how to really, she really produce food in that chawl land. And then, you know, obviously, you know, we are against tobacco consumption. I mean, this is, there is already FCTC, you know, there is a framework convention already in there, but we want to reduce the consumption level, but we are not, for example, saying we do not want to produce tobacco anymore, taking the land of the poor. So in Bangladesh, what we're doing is this, we're transforming those lands which are being used for the tobacco production into food production. Previously, many people say farmers will not be interested because it is an economic cost to them. So we have to do the research to show how they can make the transition without any economic cost to them. So it is, and we definitely have really succeeded, and it is a movement again by the farmers. Now, how we do it, say, for example, is not a very high-tech technology. You'll be surprised to see. This woman is just keeping seed, rice seed she's keeping in here, and all she does is using cow dung and put some neem leaves. You have, maybe you have heard of the neem leaves. So you put the neem leaves inside, cow dung, and also the mud, she'll seal it. And this seed will remain like this for the 3 years. No problem. And she'll get a very good regeneration end of the year. And these women cultivates, I'll give you the, you know, the strategy for that last year, 2,331 varieties of rice alone, not one or two. And they maintain 2,331 varieties of the rice with this little simple technology which was been developed. Bangladesh has 15,000 rice varieties. We have lost all of them in the name of modern agriculture. And then we had to actually submit our varieties into the IRI. And soon we have heard that there can be bioterrorism at IRI. So all our varieties have been transferred to the United States. So this is also another scope for the biopiracy as well. These varieties have been developed for thousands of years by this local community. And these varieties are not available to them right now. So we are working to bring back these varieties. And so far, we have succeeded to bring back at least with regard to the rice, you know, not less than 2,500 varieties. So how this rice variety would look like? You know, isn't it beautiful? I mean, this, of course, even culturally, is very important. If you come to any of our centers or visit Bangladesh, I promise you, we'll not offer you the same rice variety in every meal. It will be different. Okay, and if we can, for 1 year at least, I have to give you something like 1,000 varieties of rice. Yes, we are quite capable of giving you different varieties of rice. These are not the property of Bangladeshi farmer women or Bangladeshi farming communities only. These are our global heritage. This is a common that we must maintain for, because it is going to ensure the security of all of us. Because if you go for the monoculture, again for the genes that you really need, you have to go back to these poor people. They are the one who knows how to really maintain those, these rice varieties in there. You go to international gene banks, or different gene banks, they have a lot of technical difficulties. I will go detail into it, but they have already proved that they are not helping the farming communities. They're essentially helping the corporations for their breeding and also for the patenting. So these are the reason why we, you know, are critical of it. So in Noya Krishi, we take seed as an organizing tool because, you know, you maintain seed, you keep seed, you conserve seed, you regenerate seed. So whole organization is around whole seed. It's easy. You can understand why. If you maintain the seed, you can maintain the biodiversity. You can also enhance your food production. You can also do different kind of experiments, something like this. You know, that's if you go into doing the research on all the different local varieties, it's a lot of work. So we also conduct which we call the farmer-led research. And this, in this research, they're simply, you know, measuring the height of the rice plant. Now, why the height? I'll come back to you later on. But in the meantime, these are some of the rice varieties just to show you. But the reason is that if we go for the, calculate the productivity of the rice, biomass is a part of the productivity of the land, of the land, or the agriculture. So quite often when you think about the agriculture of a particular species of variety, we always think how much ton they have produced per hectare. We never discuss how much biomass they have produced per hectare. Why the biomass for? Because biomass is important for the fodder. Biomass is important for the fuel load. Biomass is important for the fertilizer. Biomass is important for the organic matter to the soil. Now if you don't use these local varieties, sooner or later, you'll end up in biofuels. Or sooner or later, you will end up with a kind of mechanization which is not actually contribute to the productivity of the total farming system. It may increase the productivity of some varieties, which is called the modern varieties. Of course, we have our cereal production increase, but oilseed production has declined. Our lentil production has declined. And a lot of other sources of protein has also been really declined. And this is another interesting thing I will just show you. Just I can't definitely go through all the details, but you know, you'll find in my paper. So if you go into the productivity, if you just go into the, simply compare the productivity of the local varieties, quite often you will hear local varieties does not produce enough. I can tell you and I can give you a quick answer, a very affirmative answer. It is a pure lie. There is no research has been done, as far as I know, at least on the Bangladesh, you know, different rice varieties.